So all please speak up.
Okay, hello everyone. I am Dr. Arvo Mukherjee, presently working as a postdoctoral fellow at Center of Excellence in Space Sciences India, which is hosted by IISER Kolkata. I did my PhD from IPR and joined here last year. So today I'll be talking about a recent work that I have carried out, an analytical work that wave breaking amplitude of electron acoustic solitary waves in an unmagnetized plasma with kappa distributed electrons. So first, the introduction and basic ideas are, scientists believe that the solution of linearized 1D Vlasov equation for an unmagnetized plasma leads to the generation of only two kinds of electrostatic modes. So before 1961, it was the belief. So one is electron plasma waves, and number two is, I think there are some noises coming up. Okay, thanks. One is electron plasma waves and number two is ion acoustic waves. But in 1961, Fried et al. Thought that in addition to the low frequency electron plasma wave and low frequency ion acoustic waves, there can also exist a family of high frequency but acoustic kind of solution of the Vlasov plasma dispersion relation, which was usually termed as electron acoustic waves because of their acoustic wave-like nature. And 16 years later, in 1977, Watanabe et al. Showed that electron acoustic waves can be generated if the plasma constitutes of two substantially different electron components. One is hot electron component and number two is cold electron component, which is distinguished by two different temperatures. And the restoring force of the electron acoustic wave comes from the pressure exerted by the hot species of the electrons, and the electron must provide the effective inertia. That's why it is a high frequency mode and it is an acoustic mode, because of the restoring force is thermal, just like ion acoustic wave. So the occurrence are shown in this figure. Now the electron acoustic waves are encountered by several satellites and other observations in the Earth Boshok and in the auroral cusp region and in the geotail region actually. And in nonlinear regime, these electron acoustic waves exhibit solitary types behavior and usually known as electron acoustic solitary waves. And it has been observed that the amplitude of the solitary waves can vary from a few volt of plasma in the plasma sheet boundary layer to 2.5 volt 1 meter in the auroral acceleration region.
Audio is not clear. Can you speak louder, a bit louder, or just shift the mic from your at a distance?
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yeah, better.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so it can we can see that the amplitude of the solitary waves actually may vary over certain range depending upon the background plasma parameters, as in different regions plasma parameters are quite different. And so the basic objective of this work is to, so one question naturally comes, what is the maximum amplitude of the electron acoustic solitary waves can sustain without losing its coherence in the plasma? And the maximum electric field amplitude that a certain plasma mode can carry is the wave breaking amplitude. And this beyond this amplitude, the crest of the wave actually overturns and the trough overturns and become fluid model becomes invalid. So in spite of having a substantial academic interest in nonlinear plasma physics, surprisingly, this problem has not been addressed yet. What is the maximum wave breaking amplitude of the electron acoustic solitary waves? So today I will show an exact nonlinear theoretical analysis to uncover the analytical expression for the wave breaking limit of electron acoustic solitary waves for a magnetized plasma. And the temperature and the hot electrons are taken as the kappa distributed electrons. So the set of nonlinear equations are basically the cold electrons follow the continuity equation, and they also follow the momentum equation, which is right hand side is the potential in the derivative of the potential, which is the nothing but the electric field, and the hot electron density and the cold electron density are basically coupled by the one dimensional Poisson's equation, which is shown in this figure. So NC and NH are the cold and hot electron species densities respectively. And here we have taken a kappa distributed electrons for the hot electrons, because now we need an expression which can actually give a relationship between density and the potential. So that's why we need a distribution, and here we have adopted the kappa distribution, and which also for certain cases may lead to a Maxwellian distribution where B thermal is given by 2k T thermal by m, and theta is the Ries parameter's normalized unit. And after integrating in the velocity space, we get the high hot electron species density is given by this term in terms of the potential, so that we can now actually put this term in the Poisson's equation to get a second order nonlinear equation of the potential in the moving frame. So these normalizations have been used for the ease of the computation. So finally, we received this analytical equation, which is in the moving frame, and phi is the potential. And this equation is not solvable analytically, and which is not in the scope of this talk also. Therefore, and where Rn and beta thermal is this parameter, we know that when we have a two electron species, two species plasma, then there must be some density ratio between the hot electron species and cold electron species. So Rn gives basically the ratio of the hot to cold electron species ratio, and B thermal is the normalized thermal velocity of the hot electrons with respect to the thermal phase velocity of the wave. And here we have shown some parameter of the wave numerical solution for two different values of Rn and B thermal, from where we actually observe that as we increase the value of Rn, the amplitude increases, and when we increase the value of B thermal, the amplitude decreases. Means amplitude increases with hot to cold electron ratio, density ratio, and decreases with the thermal motion of the hot electron species. So now this equation can be written in the pseudo potential method, in this equation, which is where u phi can be found by assuming the initial phase of the wave. So we take n u equal to 0 and phi equal to 0, and u is given by this expression. So basically now this equation shows the one dimensional motion of a fictitious particle moving in the potential given by u. And after integrating this equation, we got the energy equation for this, and we now adopt another initial condition that at psi equal to 0, phi equal to 0, and d phi d psi is equal to 0. And finally, after using this initial condition, the previous...
You have two more minutes.
Okay, the previous initial condition have been removed, and we got this area. And the variation of u for two different parameters of Rn and for different parameters of Rn and B thermal has been shown, which is shown that for a fixed value of Rn, as we increase the value of beta thermal, the amplitude of the solidarity decreases, and similarly it increases with Rn. And this minimum occurs at this value, which is independent of beta thermal, but it crucially depends on Rn. And therefore, at this point actually, the wave breaking occurs and electric field becomes maximum. So finally, we receive that this expression, and the electric field is as a function of beta thermal and Rn is shown, which shows that Emax is decreases with beta thermal in this fashion and increases with Rn in this fashion actually. So the conclusions are, we have provided the traveling wave solutions of electron acoustic solitary waves in an unmagnetized homogeneous plasma where hot electrons follow a kappa distributed distribution. And the solitary wave structures of the solitary waves crucially depend on the initial hot to cold electron species ratio. The studies have been further extended to obtain an analytical expression for the wave breaking limit using pseudo potential technique. And our study may throw some deeper insight in determining the initial wave phenomena or initial profile to be provided in a system in order to excite electron acoustic solitary waves in an unmagnetized plasma. So therefore, these results are important for conducting experiments in laboratory system where a prior knowledge of amplitude limitation is essential. Okay, thanks. Any questions can be asked.
Any questions from the audience? yeah, Professor Saini is asking to which plasma environment this model is valid. To which plasma environment this model is valid?
Basically, it is for unmagnetized plasma. The model is valid for unmagnetized plasma. Magnetic field is not taken into account.
And Shahida,
actually, how did you consider the data actually? Put some values, that's the environment, meaning you are maybe relating with some space environment.
Okay. So
where you find the electrons are following Kappa distribution and choosing that value in that regime. Okay. That is my question basically.
So where the Kappa distribution exists actually?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so mainly for astrophysical scenarios in space plasmas, mainly follow the Kappa distribution with different k values. But
which environments? There are so many space plasma environments. Which region actually?
Mainly in the Boshok region and the Kast region, polar Kast region, probably. Mm-hmm. But I'm still not sure. I need to do.
And Shahida Parveen is asking which type of soliton structure is formed in your model.
Okay, it's negative structure soliton. Negative potential structure solitons are formed in this model.
And Professor Karmakar wants to know what is your original contribution in this model. What new he wants to ask what new you have done.
Sorry, my original contribution, sorry.
Then. Yeah.
So I have calculated the complete wave breaking limit from the pseudo potential technique. It was not done earlier. So in terms of the input plasma parameters. That is my contribution in this field.
So I think we should thank the speaker now. Thank you all for such a nice talk. And the next speaker today is Pankaj Sharma, and he will be speaking on nonlinear structure formation in non-ideal protoplanary disks. Pankaj?
Hello.
Yeah, Pankaj, please share your screen.
But I'm unable to share it because some other participant is sharing at present.
No, Pankaj.
He is stopped. You can share now.
You can share now.
Yes, I can now. Yeah. Able to share. No, it's coming. You cannot share screen.
Okay. We can call him later. Okay. I think we should call.
Okay.
So meanwhile, we can have another presentation.
You please see how to open your, how to share your screen.
Meanwhile, we can have presentation from Rosina. Is Rosina ready with the presentation?
Yes, I'm ready. I'm here.
So can you just share your screen?
Yes, of course.
So we have our next speaker as Rosina, sure. And she will be speaking on new type of genes in stability and nonlinear sure. Landau damping of circularly polarized electromagnetic waves.
Yeah.
Rosina, please share your screen.
Okay. Could you see my screen now?
Yeah, it's okay now.
Okay, let me switch to the slideshow, please. So. Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks a lot, Mr. Prajapati and the organizers for giving me...
Start with the first screen so that we can have your introduction also. You have opened the fourth one. Please come on the first slide.
This is the first one here.
No, on the you are sharing the fourth.
Okay, just wait. Just wait here.
No, not in here.
Is it fine now?
Yeah, please make it full screen slideshow presentation.
This is slideshow now for me. From my side, this is slideshow now. Can you see it now?
Yeah, we can see, but it is not coming on the full screen.
You first enable editing. Please click here.
And just click on this one. Where is my mouse? Just click on this. No, just click on this. This, not this. Yeah.
Click here.
Is it okay now? Is it okay now?
Come on with this one. Slideshow, start presentation. Come on slideshow.
This is slideshow on my computer.
No, this is not on the slideshow. This left hand slides will not come.
Okay,
just come on slideshow. This slideshow,
yes, this one.
This will also work.
Yeah, this is slideshow.
Okay, start.
So, Assalamu Alaikum. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks a lot, Mr. Prajapati and the organizers for giving me an opportunity to present my research work in front of such a learned audience. As I can see, Michael Bonitz and many others are sitting here. All right, today I'm going to speak on the gravitational collapse and nonlinear Landau damping of electromagnetic waves in self-gravitating dusky plasma. This work was published with Dr. Nodar Sintasdev. Unfortunately, he's no more with us and left this world on 22nd June 2020, but I believe his brilliant contribution in science will be remembered forever. All right, in this work, we actually present a kinetic theory of gene instability of a self-gravitating dusty plasma in the presence of the nonlinear Landau damping term. We shall show here that nonlinear Landau damping will alter the growth rate of the gravitational collapse of the gravitating dusty plasma. So in fact, in this work, we are taking into account two different types of forces, the electromagnetic force and the gravitational force. So possibly we can have three possible relations between these two forces. Number one, when the electromagnetic force is less than the gravitational force, we know that this situation is relevant to the formation of the stars and galaxies. Number two, when the electromagnetic force is of the order of the gravitational force, then such situation may correspond to spoke formation in Saturn's ring. And number three, when the electromagnetic force is more than the gravitational force, such process is relevant to the radiation pressure, heating, etc. In our present investigation, we shall be considering the case number one and three. When we take into account case number one, we will be investigating the gravitational or the gene instability. And in case of electromagnetic force more than the gravitational force, we will be taking into account the nonlinear Landau damping phenomena. All right, before going directly to my work, I believe some students are also sitting here. So it will be very good for the if I just start with the basics. So what is gene instability? We know that in a star, basically there are two types of pressures, the gravitational pressure and the thermal pressure. Until these two pressures are equal, the star will be in the stable situation. But what happens when the massive particles, due to the massive particles, the gravitational pressure start increasing, and then star may start squeezing toward the center, may get the shape of a dumbbell, and then it may break down into new stars. So Jeans in 1902 put this physics in mathematical form.
Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am, but your slides are not moving. It is stuck to first slide only.
It's not moving?
Yes, ma'am. We can see only the first slide of your lecture.
You can't see. But here on my computer, this is moving. So I'm going to stop here and share again. Wait, please. So share.
Okay.
So can you see now?
No, it's the first slide coming.
Not second and not third?
No.
Okay, then.
You are not on slideshow. It's the editable.
Basically, okay. You first click at the enable editing, then it will move, I think.
No, I think he's not on the slideshow.
It is in protected view. So first you click here on the enable editing and then slideshow.
Now go to slideshow.
Now go to slideshow.
This is slideshow, na?
Yeah, now click it.
And now?
No.
Can you see? Can you see now? Okay, can I email you my presentation and then you can play?
You just scroll.
Yes, I'm scrolling and on my computer everything is fine. This is moving in my computer.
It's not coming full screen. That's the difficulty.
Ma'am, for full screen, just press F5.
Prajapati ji, it's protected view. That is why it is not coming.
Maybe.
It is protected view.
So what she can, okay. If she can email me, so
yeah.
Okay, I can email you now.
No, it is now. Now you can see.
Okay, fine. I think then I should start from again because nobody can see my slides, right?
Yeah.
So, yes. So in this work, we presented a kinetic theory of the gene stability of a self-gravitating disc plasma in the presence of the nonlinear Landau damping term. We should show here that nonlinear Landau damping term will alter the growth rate of the gravitational collapse of the self-gravitating disc plasma. So basically in this work, we will be taking it into account two forces. Number one, the gravitational and the electromagnetic forces. So we can have different regimes where these two forces are interlinked. Number one, if the electromagnetic force is less than the gravitational force, such situation we can have in the formation of the stars and galaxies. And when the electromagnetic force is of the order of the gravitational force, this situation corresponds to spore formation in Saturn's rings. And number three, when the electromagnetic force is more than the gravitational force, such process are relevant to the radiation pressure, heating, etc. In our present work, we will be considering regime number one and three. When we suppose that the gravitational force is more than the electromagnetic force, we will be investigating the genes or the gravitational waves. And when we suppose that the electromagnetic force is more than the gravitational force, we will be presenting the nonlinear Landau damping phenomena. All right. Before, can you see my slides now properly?
Yes, ma'am, we can see it.
Okay, thank you. So before going directly to my work, I think so it will be much better to explain basically what is gene instability, because I believe some students are also sitting here. In a star, we know that generally there are two types of pressures, the gravitational pressure and the thermal pressure. Until these two pressures are equal, the star is in the stable situation. But if due to the massive particles, the gravity overpowers the thermal pressure, then due to the gravity, the star will start squeezing toward the center, may get the shape of a dumbbell, and then it may break down into thus forming the new stars. Jeans in 1902 put this physics in mathematical form by using this simple set of equations, the momentum equation here, the kinetic equation, and the Poisson's equation for the gravitational potential to formulate this well-known dispersion relation of the genes instability. When the genes wave number here, when the genes wave number will be more than the wave vector, then we can see that the dispersion relation will become unstable, giving us an instability known as the genes instability. And the corresponding genes mass is expressed over here. Well, Jean in 1902 have formulated this instability for the neutral gas, and until after that, a lot of work has been done on the for the Jean's instability for the charged plasma system. As few talks before, some professor has mentioned synthesis work on Jean's and isotropic instability. This was a classic work done by me and my. And Noda Sintazde, where the first time in the literature we have shown that the gene instability could be anisotropic as well. Generally speaking, if we suppose that the interstellar matter consists of one hydrogen atom per centimeter cube at a temperature 100 kelvins, then it gives us a genes mass of the order of 8 into 10 power 48 grams, which is several times orders larger than the typical mass of a typical star. So we can say that interstellar matter first breaks into large chunks with the masses corresponding to clusters of stars rather than the individual stars, and these chunks then may keep on contracting due to the enhanced gravity, resulting in the formation of the new stars. All right, let me come to my the second work now. The second concern of the present work is the Landau damping. The Landau damping is one of the outstanding results of the theoreticians, which gives us the damping of the wave without the collisions. And if we suppose that one may assume stars as atoms of plasma interacting through the gravitational rather than the electromagnetic forces in kinetic formation of galaxies, where instability of gas of stars may cause spiral of formation, and all these phenomena are limited by the Landau damping. It also has applications in other environments such as astrophysics, wind waves, fluids, superfluids, and even biophysics. So I believe most of you are familiar with the definition of the linear Landau damping. When the phase velocity of the wave is of the order of the thermal velocity, we say that the linear Landau damping will happen. But when we speak about the non-linear Landau damping of the transverse electromagnetic wave, then this definition will not work, because the phase velocity of electromagnetic wave is more than the velocity of light. So the thermal velocity can never be in resonance with the phase velocity of the electromagnetic wave. Instead, as we know, the group velocity of electromagnetic wave is less than the velocity of light. So we can say that the group velocity could be of the order of thermal velocity, or the group velocity can be low enough to match with the thermal velocity. So the electromagnetic wave and the particles will be living together. They can interchange their energies, can give or take energies, and giving us the definition of the non-linear Landau damping. That is when the group velocity of electromagnetic wave is of the order of the thermal velocity. This gives us the definition of non-linear Landau damping, which is the subject matter of my present work. All right, so let's now come to the problem. Here, the basic formalism consists of the Poisson's equation, the Maxwell equations, the Poisson equation for the electrostatic charges, and the Poisson equation for the gravitational potential psi. Here phi is the electrostatic potential and psi is the gravitational potential. Now, if we couple these three Maxwell equations, we can have the kinetic nonlinear Schrödinger equation in the presence of the electron density oscillations here. Here, as we suppose that the plasma is isotropic, so in the Schrödinger equation, the contribution of the electron current density is more than the contribution of the ions or the dust species. And this omega p, or the longitudinal character, is appearing in fact due to the nonlinear interaction of electromagnetic wave with the plasmas. Here, Vg is the group velocity of electromagnetic wave, and delta square is the non-linear correction shift of the frequency of electromagnetic wave. Well, all right, initially investigate the linear analysis, or to formulate the dispersion relation of the kinetic genes in stability, here is the velocity equation, where F alpha is the distribution function, which we have assumed Maxwellian over here, and F bond is the ponderomotive force defined here, and del psi is the gravitational force. We know that the electromagnetic wave in vacuum has only the transversal character, but when the electromagnetic wave interacts with the plasma medium, it gives energy to the particles, and the particle may start oscillating, creating a longitudinal character EL inside the plasma medium. All right, from the definition of the ponderomotive force, we can see that the mass is sitting down. So the here in our consideration, we suppose that the ponderomotive force is important only for the electron due to their small mass. Here is the linearized velocity equation for the electron species. You can see the ponderomotive force is present here. And then this is the linearized velocity equation for the ions, which has only the electrostatic potential.
And similarly, this is the linearized velocity equation for the dusty grain. You can see the gravity effect is important only for the dusty grain due to their large mass. All right, if we if we integrate the dusty grain distribution function over the velocity space, we can get the dusty grain density oscillations expressed here, where x dot d is the omega over kV thermal, and v thermal is the dust thermal velocity. All right, and this I plus x naught d is the probability integral, which is shown here for the two asymptotics. When x is more than one, we can have this plasma dispersion expansion here.
Can you complete it within 3 minutes?
Okay, all right. And if we just suppose that for the electron ions in the dusty grain are satisfying this frequency regime, to get the electron ion and the dusty grain density oscillations expressed here, we can see that from these density oscillations, that the ion's density oscillation is much more than the electron. Or it means that in the Poisson equation for the electrostatic potential, we substitute delta Ni and delta Nd to get the dispersion relation of modified kinetic genes in stability. Here, the damping term sitting in the denominator is the something new in our this present work. And we will show that this here, if for some combination of K, omega is negative, we can have the new type of genes in stability. And also we can see from here that in the presence of the electromagnetic wave, the dust accusing frequency will reduce or will damp, resulting in the increase of the growth rate of the genes in stability. All right, next let's rewrite this dispersion relation shown here, and then we will discuss this dispersion relation for three particular cases. In fact, we will be comparing the dust acoustic frequency with the genes frequency. When these two frequencies are equal, we can show that the above equation gives us only the damping with a new definition of the genes wave number shown here. And number two, if the dust acoustic frequency is more than the genes frequency, then we can see that in this situation, again, we will be having the damping. And in the third one, if the genes frequency is more than the dust frequency, then you can see here that imaginary omega is more and we get the instability in this situation in the presence of the electromagnetic wave, omega over kV thermal term. Now, you know, let's introduce some new definition of the genes wave number. For the long wavelength case, we can have the genes wave number as 2 pi Vs over omega. Whereas for the short wavelength case, we can have, we introduce the new definition of the critical mass, which, and if the mass in the perturbations involves a mass larger than this mass, then the perturbations will grow exponentially, resulting in the genes instability. Next, then, for the in order to discuss the nonlinear phenomena, we just suppose, yes, we rewrite the electron density oscillations expressed here in the coordinate form, and just then we move to the frame of reference that that is moving with the group velocity, and here is the electron density oscillations expressed in terms of the coordinates, z coordinate, which is moving with the group velocity. And yes, then if we substitute the electron density oscillations in the Schrodinger equation, we get this new type of nonlinear Schrodinger equation, where this this second last term is the local nonlinear term, and the last term is the non-local nonlinear Landau damping term, which is appearing due to the nonlinear interaction of electromagnetic wave with the plasma medium. In order to get the damping rate, let's suppose that the amplitude of the wave is written like here. And if we suppose this A perpendicular, the value of this amplitude of the wave over here, and then we use the identities that the integral without the oscillating part gives leads to zero. Whereas in the presence of the exponential part, we do have iota pi. Then we eventually arrive at this nonlinear Landau damping rate. Here we can see that the nonlinear Landau damping rate is a function of the B naught is here is the amplitude of the electromagnetic wave. We can see that the nonlinear Landau damping is a direct function of the amplitude of the wave, and the nonlinear Landau damping is a inverse function of the ion's temperature. I mean, if we go on increasing the ion temperature, the density will go on decreasing. This effect we have shown even in this graph. You can see that as the temperature of the ions goes on increasing, the damping rate goes to decrease. So let me sum up here. A kinetic theory of gene instability of a self-gravitating plasma is developed in the presence of the electromagnetic pump wave. The damping of electromagnetic wave results in an exponential increase in the growth rate of the gene instability. The new definition of gene wave number is introduced. Then to investigate the plasma heating through the radiation process, we suppose that the electromagnetic force is larger than the gravitational force, and then constructed a new type of kinetic non-Schrödinger equation. The damping rate is computed, which is shown to be inverse function of the ion temperature, direct function of the ion's density, and a function of the amplitude of electromagnetic wave. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm sorry if you have some problem with the slides in the start of my talk. Thank you very much, and I would like to have questions, please.
Yeah, Rosina, thanks for a lovely talk, and we are not having any questions in the chat. If anybody wants to ask any question, I think they can ask you afterwards in the chat, or they can approach you directly. And due to paucity of time, I think we should not wait for the question and switch over to another speaker, Pankaj. Pankaj Sharma, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
So, Rosina, yes, thank you for a very good talk.
Thank you very much.
So do you get my screen?
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay, thank you. I'm Pankaj Sharma. I'm a PhD student at Department of Physics at the Tezpur University. And today I'm going to present about nonlinear structure formation in non-ideal protoplanetary disk. I have studied this work under the supervision of my doctoral advisor, Dr. Proloy Kumar Karmakar. These are my contents: introduction, motivation, physical model, mathematical analysis, results and discussions, conclusions, and references. Introduction. So what is a protoplanetary disk? A protoplanetary disk is a rotating disk of dense gas dust mixture around a newly formed star or a pre-main sequence star. Here in the figure, you can see the Atacama Large Millimeter Array image of H. Centauri, a pre-main sequence star with its protoplanetary disk, located at the constellation Taurus, which is 450 light years away from Earth. Here, the protostar is lying here at the center, and surrounding the star, this is the protoplanetary disk. And I'm going to study about this disk. And magnetohydrodynamics, MHD is a single mean fluidic approach dealing with its magnetoactive behavior. It's applicable in plasmas, liquid metals, salt water, electrolytes, astrofluids, etc. Ideal MHD equations describe perfectly conducting fluid in a magnetic field, and we combine electromagnetic Maxwell's equation with those of gas dynamics to provide modified equation for a field-fluid interaction. But in non-ideal MHD picture, realistic complications are to be included, such as viscosity and other dissipative properties. And we are using non-ideal MHD in protoplanetary disks. So why can we use non-ideal MHD? In the dense molecular cloud, the density of the star spaces can be much lower than the neutral spaces. In protoplanetary disk is a weakly ionized plasma. Under these conditions, the coupling between the motion of the fluid and the magnetic field is not perfect. So we have to consider a non-ideal. We have to consider the non-ideality effects by taking into account the effects of the intrinsic dissipative properties. These are our motivation. The initiation process of planet formation triggering dynamics is very complex and yet to be well understood. MHD instability in protoplanetary disk is weakly understood in the context of planet formation processes. A complete form of the involved dynamics is not reported till now, and with the thorough understanding of the process, it may be predictable the possibility of exoplanets, which is the most interesting topic among the astrophysicists today. Now this is our model. In our model, we consider the protoplanetary disk in the XY plane and the protostar at the center. And in our model, we consider rho as the mass density, tau m is viscoelastic relaxation time, zeta is longitudinal viscosity coefficient, eta is shear viscosity coefficient, psi is gravitational potential, v is the fluid velocity in the disk, b is the magnetic field in the z direction, and e is the electric field. Now I go for mathematical analysis. These are governing equations in unperturbed form. Equation one is continuity equation. Equation two is momentum equation. Equation three is gravitational Poisson equation. Equation four is Larson logarithmic barotropic equation. Here we consider three terms. Here you can see, this is the thermal term, this is the turbulent term, and this is the magnetic pressure term. And the equation five is the Gauss law of magnetostatics, and equation six is Faraday law of electromagnetic induction. Now, directional explicit form of the governing equations. We are considering Cartesian coordinates. We have three mutually perpendicular axes, and accordingly, express the equation in three directional form. Equation seven is the continuity equation. Equation eight is the momentum equation along x direction. Equation nine is the momentum equation along y direction. You can see momentum equation along x and y directions are same, because the disk doesn't know which is x axis and which is y axis. So the terms are same, except x is replaced by y in the other. Now equation 10 is gravitational Poisson equation. Equation 11 is Larson logarithmic barotropic equation of state. Equation 12 is Gauss law of magnetostatics. And equation from 13 to 15 are Faraday law of electromagnetic induction. Equation 16 is, now we go for governing equations in normalized form. So 16 is the normalized form of the continuity equation. Equation 17 and 18 are normalized equation of momentum equation along x and y directions. And here you can see, these are our normalizing parameters in our study. Equation 19 is the gravitational Poisson equation, normalized gravitational Poisson equation. And the equation 20 is Larson logarithmic barotropic equation of state. Equation 21 is the Gauss law of magnetostatics, and from equation 22 to 24 are the Faraday law of electromagnetic induction. Now, for studying excitable wave in the disk, we use multiple scaling technique, which is also known as reductive perturbation technique. And we follow equation 25. And for studying wave properties, from the structure of the wave, we can define state's coordinate from equation, from equation 29 to 31, as shown here. Now I go for order by order analysis, and I said equation 32, here you can say from continuity equation, we get all this equation, and I'm numbering only particular equation 32 and 33 here, you can see, because this equation will be used for further analysis. These from equation along x direction, and these momentum equation along y direction. These from gravitational Poisson equation, and these equations, other three equations are from Larson logarithmic barotropic equation of state. Now we have got a lot of equations. So what we're going to do next? Our goal is we choose an equation from the obtained perturbed equation by order analysis. We express that equation in terms of the perturbed gravitational potential as dependent quantity. We see the behavior of the perturbed potential with space-time variation. Hello, are you listening to me? Hello?
Yes, Pankaj, please continue.
Oh, okay. Yeah, now I go for procedural steps. Equation 34 was our previously considered equation for further analysis, and we obtain by a rearrangement of the previously numbered equation, and we get equation 37 to 39. And we want to express equation 34 in terms of the.
Yeah, there's some problem with your net connection.
Are listening?
Yes.
No? We get from 37 to 39. By rearrangement of the previous equations. Now we suppose for simplicity chi as shown in equation 40, and then we get the considered equation in terms of chi. That is, we consider chi as the gravitational potential fluctuation curvature. So we get equation 41.
To study the steady state structure of the perturbation dynamics, we define a new space S star. It's defined as X star plus Y star minus T star. And then the considered equation in terms of S star can be expressed as equation 43. And here we also define a quantity MA. It's defined as CS by CN, which results directly proportional to 1 by rho whole to the power half. We now want to see the variation of psi 1 star in S star space. Now, these are results and discussions. This is our finally obtained differential equation, equation 44. And for a graphical analysis, we use Zudisha's input values, as you can see here. These are equations. These are these values for our graphical analysis. Now, after numerical analysis, we get two graphs. One is variation of effective potential with normalized distance for various MA, and the other one is variation of effective potential gradient with various effective potential for various MA. Here you can see that as MA is increasing, MA is CS by CN. So as the density is decreasing, we can see that the amplitude of the potential fluctuation is increasing. As the MA increases, the amplitude of potential fluctuation increases. So here I can, since the potential becomes very high, so there will be very less structure formation in the disk. And here in the, we get that the area of the loop, this forms a loop structure, and area of the loop increases as you increase MA.
Pankaj, you have 3 more minutes now.
Okay. Yeah, physical interpretation. As the disk material density decreases, the potential of the disk system increases. There are certain spatiotemporal epochs of the disk system where structure forming potential collapses. The disk material density distribution has a spatiotemporal dependence. The increase of MA leads to increase of thermal pressure, as we have seen from the equation I have shown before, and the decrease of magnetic field. So the particle gets more freedom to move apart, causing the anti-disk-centric shift of the peak. And these are our conclusions. We obtain a partial differential equation dictating the evolution of the disk on the gravitational potential fluctuations. We explore the role of Alvanic Mach number in the perturbed wave amplitude amplification processes. Thermal pressure acts as destabilizing agency, as we have seen from the graph. And Alvanic Mach number and magnetic field act as stabilizing agency. These quantities play active role in the bounded structure formation via wave-induced matter accretive-decretive processes. These are our references. And finally, I want to show an interesting equation. It's called the Dirac equation. Here, this Dirac equation shows the number of civilization in our galaxy in which communication might be possible. This is this equation is treated by astrobiologists nowadays. And I saw this equation because my work is related with this term, FP. You can say the fraction of stars with planets. I mean, a fraction of stars with planets, every star cannot have planet. There may be some reason behind why some stars have planet, like our sun and some other star do not have any planet. So my study is, I mean, why some structure can be formed in some star system, not in every star system. Thank you.
Thank you, Pankaj.
Thank you.
And we don't have any questions in the chat right now. Okay. And there's an announcement from the organizers that after this talk, there will be a picture. So I would request all of you to switch on your video so that they can have a picture.
All the participants.
I would like to thank all the speakers for their talks. And it was a very informative session. And let's thank all the speakers for the invited talks as well as the oral presentations. So over to Prajapati for the...
Thank you very much, sir, for doing this great job. So I request to all, so please on your video so that we can take a picture. Please off your presentation. You can take on the gallery view. Okay, yes. Yeah, that's fine. Dr. Rosina, please on your video so that we can take a picture.
And Dr. Shraddha also.
Dr. Shraddha. Yes, you can all take now pictures. Shraddha, can you hear me? Okay, I think she's not present. So there is two announcement for you, that all the poster presenters, they have uploaded their posters on website. So you all please go through the website and see the posters and paste your comments there, and the corresponding author will give the reply of that question. And tomorrow there will be a session of 15 minutes during 1:15 to 1:30 p.m. so that the session chair will ask the questions from the presenter, and he, she is expected to give the answer. And regarding the participation certificate, we will circulate a feedback link in the closing ceremony tomorrow. So you have to submit them. And all the poster presenter and oral presentee are invited presentee. They will get a certificate, which we will prepare manually, and we will send through email. So thank you all for joining us, and let us enjoy tomorrow also. There are so many interesting talks by Professor Biren Pandey, Pintu Bandhupadhyay, A.P. Mishra, Kakoti, and there is a very nice laser plasma session in which talks of Sanat Tiwari and Vikram Saxena from IIT Delhi, and Gunjan Purohit, Dr. Swati Dubey, and few more oral presentations will be there. So thank you all for doing this painful job that you are sitting here since from 10:30. And this was a very good platform, I think. So I just tried to organize such a kind of event so that we can come under one platform and we can discuss the recent advancement in our field. So I hope you will be enjoying this conference. And tomorrow you share your experience so that in future we will be organizing this kind of activity at a large scale also, including the experimental plasma physics group also. So have a nice day. And thank you. See you tomorrow. So bye. And thank you, session chair, Dr. Puneet Kumar. Please join tomorrow's sessions also. Okay. So now let me end the meeting, today's meeting.